Lord. It's good to be back in the church, in the house of God. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we haven't solidified any plans yet, but we're looking at the end of the week for my father's services. And as the last discussions we had, as in his wishes, it will probably all take place here at the church. So that was, it'll be towards the end of the week. What we will know this afternoon. So I'll let everybody know as soon as we keep the family in. Be in prayer, be able to get through this today, so God's able. Amen.
Amen.
Let's how we came expecting to receive from God today and receive what God has for us. Praise the Lord. I hope you just let God minister to you as people come in today. And let's get ready to worship the Lord. Lord, I thank you today for the privilege and the opportunity to come into your house to worship you, to praise you. And then we're going to talk about that, to lift up our hands and praise you in adoration. And Lord, I just thank you that wherever there is two or three gathered in your name, and whenever we come to worship you, there you are in our midst, with heaven, our praise, to minister to us, to speak to our hearts, touching lives, changing lives. And Lord, I pray your anointing to fill this house, that not a single one of us that is here today would be without a touch from heaven, without your Holy Spirit ministering to us in a precious, loving, and mighty way. And I'll give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name I pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Let's worship the Lord together today. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah.
You speak to our hearts and you minister to us. You encourage us. You lift us up, Lord, as we look around us, as we live through the trials and circumstances of our life. You are our strong tower. You are our very present help in time of need. You are our waymaker. You're a miracle. That's who you are.
Yes.
Lord, I pray today for, Lord, that those that need a touch today. Lord, in Jesus' name, I pray, Lord, for those that need healing. Lord, you're still the healer, Lord. You still do miracles. Lord, I pray that you, Lord, would just touch lives today, Lord, and bring healing to those that need a touch, Lord. Lord, I pray in Jesus' name, Lord, that you would just move into wherever they are and if they're in this place today. And Lord, you would do a miracle in their lives. And Lord, you would restore, you would strengthen, Lord, you would repair. You would make new all, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the miracles that you perform. We thank you, Lord, for the testimonies of what you have done and the lives that you have touched and the lives that you have changed. And Lord, I thank you, Lord, that we can come to you all who are heavy laden. And Lord, you give us rest and you give us your peace that passes all understanding. Jesus told us that he would give us peace.
Yes.
Not as the world gives, but his peace. That peace that is beyond human understanding, that transcends the comprehension of the human mind. And Lord, I pray today as we have come into your house to worship you, and as you have seen fit to come with the privilege, our privilege, Lord, to seek your face and for you, Lord, to speak to our hearts, to give us an encouraging and uplifting word. Lord, I thank you and praise you today, Lord, that you come to minister. And I pray, Lord, today, Lord, that you would uplift those that are down. Lord, that you would let your love surround us like a sea, Lord, for those that need your love, Lord. And Lord, that those that need the compassion in the arms of the Holy Spirit to just wrap around them. Lord, I pray today, Lord, that you would minister to your this body of Christ, Lord. I pray, Lord, you would minister to my whole family in this time of loss, Lord. Lord Jesus, his gain but our loss. Lord, I pray your peace that passes understanding would come into our hearts and our minds, Lord. And Lord, we would be shocked at our peace, and we would be shocked, Lord, at our understanding that you give that no man can give. And Lord, I pray that there would be, Lord, a fresh revelation of who you are. And Lord, as sure as you would want it to be, Lord, that you would minister to each and every person that hears the word of God. And Lord, that you would minister through your Holy Spirit and through your word. Lord, and I pray today, Lord, that you would just send your comforter. And Lord, you would just comfort all who are heavy laden today. Give them rest, Lord. Give them peace. Give them strength. Give them your endurance, Lord. The joy of the Lord would be our strength, Lord. Lord, where do we look for our strength? We look to you for our strength, Lord. And Lord, I thank you and I praise you. And Lord, there is none like you. Lord, there is none that can perform like you. And Lord, I pray for every need that is presented in this body, whether they're here today or not. Lord, whether it's financial, Lord, whether somebody needs direction today. Lord, where somebody needs to hear from you today. Lord, where somebody needs answers. Lord, where somebody needs to hear, Lord, this is the way to walk in it. Close that door and walk this way. Lord, I thank you today, Lord. I hear you today, Lord. And Lord, I hear that you are providing direction in this place today. That you are speaking to someone, Lord, and providing them, Lord, with a way to go, Lord, that they didn't know or understand. And you're speaking into their hearts today. And Lord, I praise you and I thank you for that. Lord, I pray that you would, Lord, just be glorified in all that is said and done in this place. I pray that you would be glorified, Lord, as we have worshiped you and praised you. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, worship team. Praise God. Hallelujah. earlier. The services have not been set yet. Today, this afternoon, we will be doing that. It will probably be later this week. Possibly, it looks like Friday and or Saturday. Either one day or Friday and Saturday or Saturday. So, but I will get it out this afternoon as soon as everything is solidified. But as far as I know, everything will be here at the church. So, right where he would have wanted it all to be. So, where he spent most of his time. Believe it or not, I want to continue my series. You know, we're not going to let a COVID interruption derail my series.
Amen.
Present-centered worship with raised hands touching heaven. I want to talk about raising our hands today and touching heaven. You know, we do it so often as we praise the Lord, but I want to, this whole series has been about more clarity and understanding in why we worship the way we do, and the biblical basis for what we do in worship, and why it's just not a practice, it's just not an exercise, but it's something founded in the Bible that we do from our hearts, and that we do towards the Lord. And I want to turn to the book of Lamentations, chapter 3. And read a few verses from there. Starting with verse 39, then why should we, mere humans, complain when we are punished for our sins? Instead, you know, the book of Lamentations, lamenting is saying lamentations for a reason. So, and you'll see that in there, but you'll also see the other side. So, again, 39, then why should we, mere humans, complain when we are punished for our sins? Instead, let us test and examine our ways. Let us turn back to the Lord. Let us lift up our hearts and hands to God in heaven and say, notice, let us lift up our hands in heaven, and hearts and hands in heaven. We have sinned and rebelled, and you have not forgiven us. You have engulfed us with your anger, chased us down, and slaughtered us without mercy. You have hidden yourself in the clouds, so our prayers cannot reach you. You have discarded us as refuse and garbage among nations. All our enemies have spoken out against us. We are filled with fear, for we are trapped, devastated, and ruined. Tears stream from my eyes because of the destruction of my people. My tears flow endlessly. They will not stop until the Lord looks down from heaven and sees. My heart is breaking over the fate of all the women of Jerusalem. My enemies, whom I have never harmed, hunted me like a bird. They threw me into a pit and dropped stones on me. The water rose over my head and I cried out, this is the end. But I called on your name, Lord, from deep within the pit. You heard me when I cried. Listen to my pleading. Hear my cry for help. Yes, you came when I called. You told me, do not fear. Lord, you are my Lord. Plead my case, for you have redeemed my life. Lord, I thank you today for your presence here. I thank you, Lord, for the privilege again to come together in your house, brothers and sisters in the Lord, to worship you and to hear your word and to seek your faith. I pray, Lord, as I deliver your word, it would be your words and not mine. I pray the strength of your anointing to do so in an anointed fashion. And I pray, Lord, that you give us what you have for us today through me. I yield myself to you as a vessel of you. Hide me behind your cross. In Jesus' name I pray, and everybody said, amen.
Over the past several months in this series, we have explored together the fact that the seen and the unseen world, the things that are unseen that God does and the things that we see are more closely interwoven together than our merely human mind perceives or is able to comprehend. And that's what this is all about, this series. As God has shown me, it's more about showing us how what we do affects our lives and it affects the spiritual realm and how God works in our lives. Let's take a look at a basic physical expression of raising hands as a declaration of commitment. as intercession or an express or a blessing, and the clapping of our hands as a means of exalting God in a way that declares, let your kingdom come, let your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Glory to God. More than we realize, there are calls throughout the Word of God to lift up our hands. And saints, this is not simply a cultural exercise or religious exercise. I want to just focus on that. That this whole series is not about a mathematical equation. It's not about doing A, B, and C and just doing it as a religious practice. And if we do that, then A, B, or 1 plus 1 equals 2. If you raise your hands, this will happen. If you raise your hands, that will happen. It's got to be from our heart. It's got to be an expression of our heart. And we're doing it as an expression to the Lord. And it's not just, oh, pastor said lift our hands, so let's lift our hands and do this because that's what he said to do. It's not because we have said, oh, lift your hands and the lights will come on. Lift your hands and the piano will play. You know, when we walk into a room, we flip a light switch and we expect the lights to come on. It doesn't mean, well, when I want to praise the Lord, I'm going to lift my hand and, oh, I'm going to feel the lightning from heaven and the Holy Spirit's going to hit my fingertips when I raise my hand. He might do that if he wants to. Let him do it. Praise God. But that's not what this is about. It's not about just following a religious practice. It's about an expression from our heart, an expression from our inner soul and our inner being of wanting to praise the Lord with our hands and wanting to worship him with our hands and wanting to express ourselves toward him with our hands. With hands lifted up, we worship him and we sing praises to him. It's a means of touching heaven in the invisible or the unseen. With the hands of the earth and our hands here making a connection and in a way in exceeding our own explanation and how it works. You know, we just do it. We just do it because, you know, Pentecostals, we praise the Lord. We clap. We raise our hands. And that's just what we do. But to understand why are we doing it, it's biblical. It's scriptural to do it. But we don't do it just because the Bible says, do it, walk two steps, raise your hand. I do solemnly swear. No, it isn't that. It's because we want to praise the Lord. We want to express ourselves in a physical manner. And it's not just, oh, I want to just let emotion roll toward. No, we are expressing ourselves in many different forms. And we'll talk about four aspects of that in a moment. We learn about the relationship between our hands of praise and the hand of Almighty God, the all-powerful God. How our hands raised from an expression from our heart has the hand of God working in our lives, whose power and authority we desperately need. And we need that in our lives, saints. If there's ever a time when we need that in our lives, we need that today. Glory to God. Don't get nervous because I have 4 points. Doesn't mean that it's any longer than normal, so don't get nervous. But 4 aspects of the purposes of why we raise our hands and why do we raise our hands? The first one is confession. Not confession to somebody else like some do. No, this is confessing our commitment to the Lord. Genesis chapter 14, verse 22. But Abram said to the king of Sodom, with raised hand, I have sworn an oath to the Lord, God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, that I will accept nothing belonging to you, not even a thread or the strap of a sandal, so that you will never be able to say, I made Abram rich. I will accept nothing but what my men have eaten and the share that belongs to the men who went with me, to Aner, Eshcol, and Mamre. Let them have their share. What is this talking about? This is talking about Abraham lifts his hands as a confession of his commitment to the Lord, telling the king of Sodom that I have raised my hand to the Lord, the God, the Most High, the creator of heaven and earth, and I have raised my hand in an oath and a commitment to him. Well, why is he doing this? You ask me that, so I'll answer it probably. Why would he be doing this if you don't know the story? But if you do, Abraham is returning from the battle, having rescued his nephew Lot, and others, not just Lot, and they were taken captive from Sodom by a group of kings and the surrounding nations. And Abram is confronted by the king of Sodom, the pagan king, I might add, of Sodom. And he says to Abraham, if you just will let me have all of the people that you rescued, I'll let you keep all of the spoils and I'll let you keep everything, all the goods that you gain from that. But you give me all the people. It's a ransom. And he's saying to him, give me the people back that you rescue, and I'll give you all the goods. You know, the enemy does that to us. He wants us to give up things that God has given us. He wants us to give up our commitment to the Lord so that, and he'll give us material gain for it. And it won't get you anywhere when we get to heaven. It won't get you anywhere in heaven. You can't take it with you. Abraham is confronted with this. And what does he do? He raises his hand and he says to the king of Sodom, he makes it clear whose side he's on. And I want you to get this, because this, the Lord really struck this to me. He refuses to be identified with that which is in opposition to the Lord. He refuses to be identified with that which is in opposition to the Lord. He refuses to give in to something that is in opposition to God, something that is on the other side of what God, and not on God's side, not what God would want him to do. He refuses to cave in for material gain, to give up those people for his material gain. He's tempted, and he says to him, I will not accept anything that belongs to you, not even a thread or the strap of a sandal. I won't accept anything from you. I don't want you to say that you made Abraham rich. I don't want you to say that you were the one that made me prosper because I gave up those that I had gone to rescue. He set his commitment. And I really thought, as saints and followers of Christ, that we raise our hands in confession to our commitment to the Lord and refuse to be identified with anything in opposition to the Lord. Again, remember, I'm not talking about this is just a religious exercise. I'm not talking about picking a day and walking down Main Street with your hands up. I'm following Jesus. Well, if the Lord tells you to do that, go ahead. I'm not saying you shouldn't. But I'm saying that the Bible isn't telling us that just the mere declaration. But Abraham was tempted and he stood his ground. And from his heart he said, no, I choose the Lord. I choose with God. I choose the side of God. I choose to be a person, a man. He's not a woman, but we choose to be a man or woman of God, and we're going to choose to not be identified and not to do and be like those that would be pagan and give in to them. Romans 4:12 elaborates a little more. And Abraham is also the spiritual father. We've heard this several times over the last several weeks, months. The spiritual father of those who have been circumcised, but only if they have the same kind of faith Abraham had before he was circumcised. Clearly, God's promise to give the whole earth to Abraham and his descendants was based not on his obedience to God's law, but on a right relationship with God that comes by faith. That comes by faith. See, he had the faith to say, you know, oh, those riches look pretty good. He's going to let me keep all of that. I just got to give these people back to him. I just got to do this or I just got to do that. And cave into the pagan king and give him his way, instead of God's way. Why'd you go in the first place? If that was the case. But Romans goes in and it was because of his relationship with God and his faith in God that he chose the right thing. He did the right thing because he had his faith in God to know that God is Jehovah Jireh, the supplier of all our needs. And he didn't need the material things from the pagan king of Sodom. He wanted relationship with his God who had promised him. And he didn't need the king of Sodom to give him a kickstart into the prophecy that God had given him. He didn't need the king of Sodom to give him something to fulfill what God had promised him. Are you getting that? That's extra that wasn't even in the notes that the Lord just gave me now. He didn't need what the king of Sodom wanted to provide because he wasn't being used as a vessel of the Lord. He had his faith in God. What a testimony for us, saints, as we live in the world we live in today. Our faith in God and keeping our faith in him. It's not just Abraham regarded as the spiritual father of the New Testament believers. We can follow his example to raise our hands in expressing our commitment to the Lord, not just as a religious exercise or a tradition, but as a heartfelt expression of our allegiance and commitment to God. You know that song, it's an older song, and we haven't sang it in a while, but that song we sang today, "When the World Wonders Why," we'll just tell them we're loving our King. We'll just tell them we're committed to Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. When they ask us, why are you raising your hands? Why do you raise your hands? We'll just tell them we're loving on our King. We'll just tell them we're expressing our gratitude and commitment to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Secondly, we can raise our hands in times of conflict, gaining the victory in spiritual warfare. And there's no better example than this in Exodus chapter 17, verse 10. So many know the story as I will read it here. So Joshua did what Moses had commanded and fought the army of Amalek. Meanwhile, Moses, Aaron, and Hur climbed to the top of the nearby hill. As long as Moses held up the staff in his hands, the Israelites had the advantage. But whenever he dropped his hand, the Amalekites gained the advantage. The scripture tells us here, as long as Moses' hands were raised, Israel had the upper hand in the battle. And while his arms became tired, he sat down. And Aaron and Hur, they supported his arms to help keep him up. You know, again, saints, this isn't just a religious practice. We don't read this and say, oh, you know what? I got this meeting today I'm going to have, or I got this meeting next week I'm going to have, and I know the devil's going to be in it, so I got to pray, and I'm going to raise my hands. I want you to get this. I don't want to oversimplify it, and I don't want to go way in the other, but I want you to understand it's an expression of our heart saying, Lord, in Jesus' name, victory. I'm going to see a victory. The battle belongs to you, Lord. The battle belongs to you. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1, first of all, then I urge that petitions, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be offered for everyone, for kings and all those in authority. Saints, when I put this together several weeks ago, but when I was re-going through it, Lord spoke to me on this. Hear this. It's the apostles writing to Timothy. The kings and all those in authority, so that we may lead tranquil and quiet lives in all godliness and dignity. Praying, saints. This is good and pleasing in the sight of God, our Savior, who wants everyone to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, there is one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony that was given just the right time. For this reason, I was appointed as a preacher and apostle and faithful and true teacher of the Gentiles. I'm telling you the truth. I'm not lying about anything. Therefore, I want the men everywhere to pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or dissension. He's saying, people everywhere, individually and collectively, lift up your hands, holy and undefiled by sin, free from wickedness, free from sin. What's our motive when we do it? What's our motive? Paul is saying to Timothy here, pray for those in authority. Boy, if there's ever a time that we need to be doing this, we watch it and we get angry, I'm sure. We watch it and we say the world is upside down. We watch it and we think, what in the world are those people even thinking? I won't go any deeper than that. And Paul is giving us what he told them then. If you want to live in peace and tranquility, you got to pray for them. For them. Because why? He says, he goes into it. Christ is not willing, God is not willing that one person should perish. And we can see those in leadership that may appear to be the most evil and vile. They had them back then too. Ahab, Jezebel. We could go into a lot of them. King of Sodom. They were evil too. But we have to pray. Lift up our hands. Holy hands. What is it saying? It's saying with the right heart, lifting up our hands. Strike them dead, Lord. No, that's not what the scripture's telling us. That's not what the Bible says. Lord, show them the light. Show them your light. Lord, let them see you. Lord, let them see you and me at the opportunity when we do. Lord, send somebody to that leader. Let them be influenced by a man or woman of God that has power of God in their lives, and let them see God working. I believe God is going to show us that he's at work. He's showing us already. And we think the world, it is upside down. We think that it's going in the wrong direction, but the Bible says that it would all happen. But God is telling his people. He's telling his people, as he said here already, he is on the throne. And although the world is crazy, and although it seems like things are, but that's what the Bible says is going to happen. I don't like it any better than anybody else. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand. But I know this, saints, I know who holds tomorrow. And I know he holds my hand. He holds our hands, saints. In conflict, let us lift up our hands in worship. Paul's telling people everywhere, lift up your hands in intercession with a heart of worship that we might attain the victory. That we might attain victory in the name of Jesus Christ. In confrontation, we lift up our hands, not laying on of hands suddenly, but we lift up our hands in confrontation while running for his life in the wilderness of Judah. David sings this song in Psalm chapter 63. O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. To see thy power and thy glory, so I have seen thee in the sanctuary. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Thus will I bless thee while I live. I will lift up my hands in thy name. And in the New Living Translation, verse 3 and 4 says this, your unfailing love is better than life itself. How I praise you, I will praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer. To make this practical, because that's what the Bible's all about in our lives, we have to realize and understand the context of this. In spite of what David is going through, He's lifting up his hands in prayer in spite of what he's going through. He could be killed at any moment. He's on the run. He could be killed at any time, in any moment. But wait a minute. He's supposed to be king. And he's on the run. The promise was for him to be king. Why is he on the run? He raises his hands to express his affirmation that the loving kindness of the Lord never changes. It never changes. He never changes. And it's better than life itself because our Lord is always worthy of our praise. Remember that song, "Thy loving kindness is better than life." Old chorus, "Thy loving kindness is better than life. My lips shall praise thee, thus will I bless thee. I will lift up my hands in thy name. I will lift up my hands in your name." That's the chorus. "I will lift up my hands in your name. And then and my lips shall praise thee, thus will I bless thee. I will lift up my hands in thy name." In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. In confrontation, we lift up the name of Jesus and we raise our hands and praise the Lord and worship to him, reaching out to God with raised hands in times of trials. In songs of praise is an invitation to our Almighty God to lift us up beyond our trial and beyond our circumstances. Like David, let us confront the things that distress us with uplifted hands, praising God, lifting up our hands in his name. Glory to God, saints. We got to praise the Lord. We got to lift up our hands and praise the Lord from our heart. In times of conflict, in times of confrontation, we got to call upon the name of the Lord and reach out and reach our hands toward heaven and touch heaven. Glory to God. And in times of blessing, during the dedication of the temple, Solomon prays this wonderful prayer, and he's commending the ways of the people of the Lord. And then he finishes in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 54. When Solomon finished making these prayers and petitions to the Lord, he stood up in front of the altar of the Lord, where he had been kneeling with his hands raised toward heaven. And he stood in a loud voice and blessed the entire congregation of Israel. This was kind of a dual employment here, because in the beginning there was intercession of prayer and then he was blessing the people. And you know, we just do that. You know, when I close and I raise my hand and I'm saying, "Lord, I pray a blessing on everybody here. Bless them, keep them." You know, it's not like I'm throwing something at you. It's not like I'm just raising my hand just to, why do we do it? We do it as an expression. We express ourselves to the Lord and for the blessing of others. We cannot overlook that there is spiritual significance in hands raised in the presence of God and our living God that can be extended to others. Here's where extending to others. In Mark chapter 16, verse 17, these miraculous signs will accompany those who believe. They will cast out demons in my name. They will speak in new languages. They will be able to handle snakes with safety. And if they drink anything poisonous, it won't hurt them. They will be able to place their hands on the sick, and they will be healed. Reaching out with raised hands. Raised hands in intercession and prayer, and extending our hands to others that they might receive their miracle. Reaching out and lifting up our hands before God, because we need the touch of God upon our hands if we're going to employ them upon others. We can't reach out and give what we don't already have. If God is not working in our lives, if the power of God is not evident and working in our lives, we can't give it to somebody else. We can't reach out and give it to somebody else. If God is not working in my life as a minister of the gospel, and I'm praying for people at the altar, if he's not working in my life because I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do, then I'm not going to be able to, I have nothing to give. Because he's what I am giving. I am giving of myself to him, and he through me. I am the vessel of him, that's all. And it's not just for preachers. We can pray for one another. We can bless one another. And we pray and we lift up our hands. And we do it as an expression. And you know, you're probably saying, yeah, we've done this for years. You know, we see. But it's an understanding, because the Lord is taking us into a deeper understanding of why we do what we do. Why? And when the world wonders why, just tell them we're just loving our King. Just telling them that you're praising God to bless somebody else. Just tell them that you're worshiping and praising God through a conflict in your life. Just tell them and let them understand that you're praising God in a time of trial, in a time of stress and circumstances. If that's the case, I'm sure we could all be walking around with our hands up all the time and need people to help hold them up so they don't get tired. Raising our hands to the Lord is a fundamental part of our turning to the Lord, as the writer of Lamentations declares here. In verse 40 of Lamentations 3, instead, let us test and examine our ways. Let us turn back to the Lord. Let us lift up our hearts. Does that mean our heart? No, it means our soul, our depths. It doesn't mean our physical heart. It means who we are inside, our expression. Lift up our hearts and hands to God in heaven and say, we have sinned and rebelled, and you have not forgiven us. Notice what Jeremiah in verse 41, let us lift up our hands, or let us lift up our hearts and our hands. As with any true and pure expression to the Lord, raising our hands originates from our heart, and it's not a mere exercise. It's not just an exercise. I really want to get that across, that, you know, I don't want us to think that, you know, it's just like we can all walk into church and raise our hand, and God's going to, okay, every Sunday we are going to start a new practice. When you walk into church, whatever door you use, raise your hand and the Lord's going to touch it. Just walk through the door. Now, if the Lord tells me to tell you that, I'll tell you that. But if he doesn't tell me to tell you that, you can walk around with your hand up all day. You can be tired, your arm can be sore, and you can walk around all day till the blood comes out of your hand and it's all in your arm and it falls asleep. If it's not an expression from your heart, if you're not, there's no belief and faith behind it. It's a mere exercise. Physical exercise. Religious exercise. You fit right in with the Pharisees if you want to do that. We'll just lift our hands. I wash so many times a day. I do this, I do that. We walk through the door, and we raise our hand. Everybody, walk. So next week when you come in, you're going to think about that, right? When you walk into church, you're going to walk in and think, oh, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And raise your hand. But you know what? If you come in and you're like, woo, glory. Let the dew of heaven fall upon my thirsty soul today. Watch out. You might not make it to the pew. Glory to God. You might end up rolling to the pew on the floor. Or people be just stepping around you to get to where they're going. Jeremiah tells us, let's lift up our hearts and our hands, lamenting, and he's crying out to God in intercession till the end of verse 54. And then in 55, he turns it to praise and acknowledging the wonders of God, so much like David would do. Lamentations 3:55, but I called on your name, Lord, from the deep within the pit. You heard me when I cried. Listen to my pleading. Can you be, how many of us? Put yourself here. Lord, please listen to my cry. Hear my cry for help. And then you, yes, Lord, you came. See, I'm doing it. Yes, Lord, you came. And you told me, do not fear, Lord, for you're my lawyer. You plead my case, for you have redeemed my life. And then he goes back into prayer. I'm going to close. The Word of God is filled with examples of raised hands expressed in prayer, intercession, and praise. And we do it and we express it from our heart. We'll sing that. We will worship the Lamb of Glory when we close here. We've looked today at raising our hands as a confession and an acknowledgement of our commitment to the Lord. And only to Him as Abraham did. Not committed to this world and its material things and its fame, but committed to God and walking in His will. We talked about raising our hands in conflicts and battles. This is how I fight my battles. Raise my hands and raise a hallelujah. It might look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by the Lord. I raise my hands and I raise a hallelujah. Our victory is dependent on our expressing our praise in times of conflict. Raising our hands in trials and confrontation. Offering praise in times of trials. David was running for his life. And he chose to raise his hands and voice and praise the Lord. The rest of the worship team, if you want to come up. Raising our hands and reaching out to bless others. To pray for others. Solomon lifted his hands to heaven and prayed a blessing on the congregation. Notice we talked about holy hands. Does it mean we're holy? No. It means we're in right attitude and we're in right motive when we're praying. We're in faith, believing. If you aren't going to believe, don't pray for somebody. I'll pray for him, but, you know, I don't really know if God's going to do it or not. I'll have somebody else pray, thanks. Or how about it's that person that you never really saw eye to eye with? God tells you to pray for him. You know how he does that, right? And you're praying for him, and you know the back of your mind, you want to pray a sinus infection on them. I'm just making it practical here.
Is our heart pure and we're saying, the Lord is willing that not one should perish. And even the people that cross us, even the people, the Bible says that He will even make our enemies at peace with us. Are our motives pure when we are going to pray for something, when we lift our hands and worship and praise the Lord? Are we? And that's what it talks about, holy hands. And we're touching someone, praying for someone. Is our mind, are we focused on their best and what God has for them? And now I know that was a pretty graphic example, but I think we get the picture when we talk about like that. It's practical. Maybe you wouldn't be that way, but you know, sometimes we can get pretty angry as humans, and we don't want somebody else to be happy that made us not happy in our flesh. But with God, all things are possible. The Lord can work in our lives to change how we think, how we act, Does that mean we're going to be perfect? No. Does that mean we won't slip up? No. Does it mean that it's easy? No. Anybody that tells you that, I don't know what Bible they're reading. They got the wrong version, and it's not what the Word of God says. But just remember that Christ has a sense of humor. He calls them light and temporary trials and circumstances. Why? Because they're not eternal. You know, I'm not preaching his funeral now, but I said to somebody the other day for my dad, I'm going to miss him. Everybody's going to miss him. But if there's ever a time to leave this earth and go to heaven, it surely is now. His gain, our loss. He's in glory. David and him are playing trumpets together, probably. He's singing up there with all he's got, playing the trumpet. He's in, I don't know if he's in the choir or in the band. He probably But he's asking us today, and he showed us in the scripture how important it is. So I would encourage you today, from your heart, intercede today as we sing this song, in prayer, in worship, in praise, in your conflict, in your trial, in your commitment to him, in expressing your commitment to him, and expressing a blessing upon others here and those in your family and those that you interact with. So let's sing it together again. Verse 1.
Yeah.